Hello everyone, welcome back to Introduction to Semiconductor Devices. This week we will start discussing one of the most fundamental semiconductor devices, which is a p-n junction. So a p-n junction is simply can be thought of as something that is shown here. So we can take a p-type semiconductor and an n-type semiconductor. So p-type semiconductor is doped with acceptor ions and n-type semiconductor is doped with donor ions. And then if they form a junction, then you can have a p-n junction. So simply as the name implies, right? But it is not that simple. The reason for that is this particular junction, it's very, very crucial. Okay. Quality of this junction is crucial. If you simply take a piece of n-type semiconductor and a piece of p-type semiconductor and join them together, you are going to have a lot of defects on the interface, because we saw that the lattice matters a lot, and whenever the lattice breaks at the edge of a semiconductor, you have a lot of what are called as dangling bonds, so unsatisfied covalent bonds. Okay, when you have these dangling bonds, that can result in trapped states within the band gap, and that can deteriorate the quality of electronic devices. So you can't simply take a piece of n-type and p-type and put them together to form a p-n junction. So what can we do? Well, we have to follow a series of processing steps to realize a p-n junction. So what we can do is, in its simplest form, we can take a wafer. Let's take a piece of wafer, which is, let's assume that it is doped p-type, uniformly doped with p-type semiconductor, p-type dopant. So p-type semiconductor we'll take. And then I'll convert some region of it into n-type. The way I can do that is by doing a series of processing steps. Okay, so if you look at the latest technology right now, if you want to make a chip, the process steps involves something like 2000 or more steps. Okay. It's a very, very complicated process, but we can simplify it. We'll say that I want to have a small region in the center here. I want to make it n-type. Okay. This is what I want. Okay. So how would I make it n-type? So what I can do is, I'll take this p-type wafer and then I'll do a processing step which is called as lithography. So essentially what I'll do is, I will cover this wafer with what is called as a photoresist. Okay. Photoresist. The way to do that again is involved. We don't need to get into it. I'll cover it. So essentially what this photoresist does is, it will block some type of atoms. Okay. So I'll do this lithography step. And then I will do a step which is called as diffusion. So what we can do is, we'll take this wafer covered with photoresist and then put it in a chamber containing dopants. For example, if you want to make it n-type, you need to put it in a chamber containing phosphorus or arsenic atoms. Okay, you can have a gas of phosphorus or arsenic, heat it up so that the phosphorus and arsenic atoms get a lot of energy, and then that energetic ions will actually get into will diffuse into the wafer. So originally this was a p-type wafer. And you could imagine basically a gas of everywhere. You create a chamber, you put it in a chamber containing, I'll just show a gaseous cloud here essentially. So basically this will be phosphorus or arsenic gas, okay, which is heated. So when it's heated, some of these atoms will actually hit the surface and then diffuse into the substrate, okay. So that will actually cause the doping to change. This sort of a process I will call as diffusion. So I will do a diffusion step. So simply, if you take a room and then you open an alcohol bottle, let's say, the alcohol vapor will come out and then you can smell it, right? So it's alcohol atoms, vapors are diffusing in the room, right? Similarly, here, the gaseous atoms will diffuse into the lattice. Of course, because this is a lattice, it's a solid, right? The rate of diffusion is going to be very, very low. It's not easy for the gas to actually go through the lattice, right? So that's why we have to increase the temperature. Typically, this is done at 700, 800 degrees centigrade or so, okay, at high temperatures, so that the diffusion happens faster. Okay, so we can do this process, or this was originally in the 60s and 70s we used to do this, but nowadays, you know, more of it is done by what is known as implantation. Okay, I'll also mention that implantation. So what ion implantation? So essentially what we do in this process is, as I said, diffusion is slow, so we don't depend on diffusion, but instead we accelerate these ions, phosphorus or arsenic ions. We can actually accelerate, we can pass it to a particle accelerator, and then they acquire a higher energy, kinetic energy, and then you bombard them into the lattice. So you can actually make the doping process faster. Okay. And there are some advantages, of course, you know, there are disadvantages as well. So anyway, that is the topic of a processing or VLSI technology course. For us, essentially, it is enough to know that we get a diffusion of these ions. So essentially, you'll have some arsenic or phosphorus atoms penetrating into the p-type substrate. And then we will simply remove the photoresist. Okay. And then what you'll be left with is something which is looking like this. Okay, so P type, and then I'll have a region of N type. Okay, that's how we will actually realize a PN junction. All right, so if you are paying attention, you might recognize that we did what is called as compensatory doping. Remember compensatory doping we mentioned in the last week? So essentially, if you try to, let's say, plot, I'll take this axis, okay, I'll take this axis and I'll label it as X. Okay, if you plot, you know, the doping concentration along X, and I'll take this to be the junction, okay, X equal to zero, I'll take it. We'll also call it metallurgical junction. Junction, essentially the junction between the P and the N regions, okay, that the point where the type of doping change. So we'll plot it that way, or rather, let's simplify it. Okay, I'm sorry, let me simplify it. We'll do it in it. We'll start using this notation in the next part. Right now, let's assume this is x equal to zero. The top of the wafer is x equal to zero. Okay. I did this for a reason. Anyway, so let's plot out the doping as a function of x. Okay, this is x. Well, I should actually take x is going downwards. Okay. So this is doping. Let's this will be ND or NA. Okay, so when I do this, essentially, you can originally see that if you take the original wafer, that was a p-type wafer, so I'll have a doping concentration which was uniform, right? So I'll have Na, uniformly doped region. And then I introduced n-type dopants by diffusion process. But this diffusion process is not going to be, you know, not going to produce uniform doping, okay? So typically, diffusion process produces a shape which is looking like this. So you have more of dopants on the top surface, and as you go into the wafer, the concentration reduces, okay? So essentially, this is going to be the depth of diffusion depth, you could say. Okay, so this can be controlled. Let's say, for example, I take a higher temperature, I can control, increase the diffusion depth. If I do it for a longer time, I can increase the diffusion depth. But there are some limitations. Within some limitations, we can tweak these parameters and you get some profile like this. Okay. If you are having implantation, the profile will be slightly different, but for practical purposes, we can assume they're same for, as far as PN junctions are concerned. Okay, so if you get this, so what's happening? Essentially, in this region, right, in this region, you have compensatory doping. Okay. So if you really want to make it p-type, we need to make sure that, sorry, if you really want to make it n-type, you need to make sure that ND that you're doping, right, that is greater than NA. Only then you get the n-type doping. If not, you don't get the n-type doping. So this is a serious limitation for us, right? But so we have to, okay, we will tell you how to actually overcome this in a moment. So yeah, this is how you fabricate a PN junction. All right. So now let me try to show you a slightly more complicated process. This is actually the cross section of a actual p-injection that might be fabricated in an IC. You see that it's a little bit more involved. We said that if you have a fixed type of dopant, right, p-type, if you take a p-type substrate, then you don't have a whole lot of flexibility, okay? Because everywhere, all across your wafer, your devices have to have the same type of doping, right? Same amount of doping. That is not advisable, or that is not convenient for us. We would like to have independent doping. No, remember, if you have a wafer which is like, let's say, 12-inch wafer, you'd be making, I don't know, thousands and thousands of diodes, let's say, on it. Okay, you're going to make like multiple diodes on the same wafer, right? You're not going to use the entire wafer for one diode. If you use the entire p-type substrate as a, as one of the p regions, then you don't have that much of flexibility in changing the doping concentrations. So we introduce what is known. We start with an n-type wafer. Again, this is one type of process flow. You could always have different types of process flows depending on what is convenient for us. Okay, so you start with an n-type wafer. P-well essentially it is introduced to control the p-type concentration. P-type concentration, right? So I can make two adjacent diodes, and both of them can have a different p-type concentration, right? So I can have different p-wells depending on, I can adjust the dose in my implantation step. If you use diffusion, it might not be possible, but ion implantation has an advantage that you can actually adjust the dose locally, and you can have different p-wells with different types of p-type dopants. Okay, and then of course introduce n-type wafer. Okay, well, that again is, again, a lithography step has to be done. Even for the p-well, there has to be a lithography step. So you create a, photoresist mask. Mask is essentially something that will block the diffusion or implantation process. So you open a window where you want a p-well, implant or diffuse. Then again, do a photolithography, open a smaller window, implant or diffuse an n-type wafer. N-type, sorry, n-type dopant. So that way, you can get a p-n junction, but you also want to have connections, right? Always, we want connections to the external world. You can't simply leave it like that. So we have to make what are known as contacts. Right? Remember, if you are talking about bulk size, macroscopic devices, it's very easy. For us, it's easy to visualize. But you have to do it on the micrometer scale, or right now, p-n junctions are made in the nanometer scale. If you want to have that sort of a precision, think about what needs to be done. You cannot do it like what you do in the regular, welding kind of a thing. You can't do, right? It's a much, much smaller dimension. So the whole field of nanotechnology, right now, whatever is known as nanotechnology, most of it is developed for the sake of advancing the semiconductor devices. We have, I mean, these tools and techniques, whatever I mentioned, diffusion, lithography, and so on, implantation, all these were developed so that we can achieve nanoscale devices. So I would say that nanotechnology, whatever we know today, is a byproduct of semiconductor revolution. Right? So yeah, so we can make this p-type p and n junctions, and then we have to make a contact. How will you make a contact? Again, lithography step. Okay, you do lithography step, put a photoresist, or in this case, we are actually photoresist is actually it can be removed easily. It's an organic material. So if you want to actually protect and you want to insulate the p-n junction, you will put a silicon dioxide, okay? And then open a small window in that. This is insulation, silicon dioxide. And the way to open a window is basically to put a silicon dioxide and then try to etch it in a small window, okay? Again, it's a little bit more complex, but I'll make a connection to aluminum. In this case, I have deposited aluminum. I'm showing that it is an aluminum. So then you can make a connection, okay? So imagine, this is just the lowest part of, the most basic level. If you have, let's say, 10 diodes on your wafer, okay, how will you connect them? Right? Imagine, you are actually making these diodes in, let's say, at the spacing of, 100 nanometers each. And then you want to connect them in some way. We have to think of how to metal, I mean, you have to run a metal line, right? You might have seen a PCB in a computer or, in a TV, right? If you open a PCB, you'll see a lot of these copper wires going all around. So those are all connections between devices, right? We do something similar in the IC technology, wherein we'll run various levels of metals, and then we make these interconnections. Okay. So yeah, that's how you make a p-n junction in the realistic sense. Now, let me tell you the various types of p-n junctions. Okay, so we briefly mentioned this, this sort of a distribution of doping concentration, wherein initially we had a, let's say, substrate with, let's call it, right now I'll take it as, for convenience, I'll take it as ND. Okay, that means I'm having an N-type substrate, and ND or Na will be the doping concentration. Okay, so basically I can have a diffusion process which will create my P region. Okay, so if you do that, how will the doping profile look like? That's what we want to identify. Okay, so to do that, what I'll do is I'll draw a plot of ND minus NA versus X. Okay, so you see that, in this particular region, you have both ND and NA, right? So ND minus NA will be lower. So if you are at large X, you're going to have a flat ND like this, right? And as you come closer to this point, okay, as you come closer to this this point, then your doping concentration changes, and it will become something like this. So essentially, I'm doing both in the same plot, so I'm just showing you ND minus NA. Okay, so this is an important feature. By actually controlling the, the way the profile of, diffusion profile looks like, I can control the way your junction looks like. This sort of a behavior. Now, ideally, what you would want is, a profile like this. Okay, wherein there is a very sharp cut or sharp change between N-type and P-type regions. Okay, so this I would call as an abrupt junction. So wherein my profile basically is that ND minus NA is equal to ND for X greater than, let's call it the junction to be zero. Okay, just right now I'm taking it to be zero. Okay, X equal to zero, I'm taking this and change the notation. Okay, please just note that. In the previous graph, I wanted to show you from the top of the wafer, so I took X equal to zero in the top, but right now I'm taking at the junction X equal to zero. So for ND minus NA equal to ND for X equal to X greater than zero, and it is ND minus NA is equal to minus NA for X less than zero. So I have a junction which is very, very sharp. That is known as an abrupt junction. Okay, but you see that it's clearly not going to be that, easy to get an abrupt junction. You can get an approximation to an abrupt junction, but most often than not, it's going to be something slightly different. So most often, maybe it might be something like this, right? Wherein your ND and NA at the junction is actually proportional to X. There's a slope, right? So you can also have junctions which are having doping concentration of the form ND minus NA is equal to some, let's call alpha times X. So what I'm trying to say is the doping concentration is going to be proportional to X. So this is called as a linearly graded junction. So I mean, as the name implies, the doping concentration is linearly changing with X. You can also have more complicated doping profiles, secant profiles and all that, but it's a better approximation to the real situation. That's why people study them. But for this course, we will just solve a couple of problems with linearly graded profile. Otherwise, most often we deal with abrupt junction. That is the simplest form for us to analyze. You can also have what are known as P plus N junction. Okay, I don't know if you noticed in one of the previous cases, there was a mention of P plus or an N plus region. Okay, this P plus means the P doping is high. Okay, so basically related to the N doping, P is region much more highly doped. So it could be something like n. Let's assume if it nd was, let's say, 10 power 15 centimeter inverse, and a, let's say, is 10 power 19 or 10 power 20 centimeter inverse. So basically, the p is highly doped related to n. That's why we call it a p plus junction. So sometimes these are also called as one-sided junction. It will become clearer in the next couple of lectures why it is one-sided. One-sided junctions we call them. Okay. You could also have, p n plus junction. N can be highly doped related to p. That is also possible. It's not going to make any difference. But anyway, p plus n junction or n plus p n plus junction. So basically, one type of one of the material is highly doped, the other material is moderately doped. So you call this. Okay. And you can also have another interesting sort of a semiconductor device, which is known as PIN PIN diode, okay, PIN junction. So here, what we do is we have the same material, let's say, but now I have P region, N region, and intrinsic region in between. Basically, here, intrinsic region is sandwiched between P and N regions. Okay. So I'll leave some part of it, like, let's say it's perfectly compensated, so you have effectively intrinsic region. Okay. This has a lot of applications, in especially optoelectronic devices. Okay. We will see that in the last couple of weeks of the course. But anyway, in the next week, we will see, in this week or next week, we'll see how to analyze a PIN junction. It becomes a very interesting, we'll understand the electrostatics of the PIN junction. Okay. And then the optoelectronics part we'll see in the end. All right. So, yeah, these are different types of junctions. So, in the next module, we will talk about the electrostatics. All right. So, I'll meet you there. Thank you so much.